Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. Today, Kim Weisskopf's study of cinema murder comes to life. Play Pigeons. Starring Lee Meriwether. In the Mutual Broadcasting System presentation of The Zero Hour.
Brought to you by the Ford Motor Company, also by Sinoff, Tablets and Spray, Beechnut Chewing Tobacco, and International Harvester.
Set in the make-believe world of movies. That gray area where reality wavers between fact and fiction. Actors are a strange lot. We tend to view them in two ways, as the characters they portray on celluloid and as real people. But in both cases, they seem larger than life. We're about to meet Lily Clay, a woman whose job it is to funnel our interest into the personal phase of actors' lives. Millie Clay is a gossip columnist. She calls her column, and we call our story, Clay Pigeons.
When dear friend Norman Sharnoff invited me on location for his new picture, little did I dream how much action I would see both on and off camera. Norman's directing Bees in a Bonnet here in the Mojave Desert, and his co-stars, luscious Paul Helms and sultry Robin Albright, have been doing their best to render the title an understatement. Well, today, for the first day in five, shooting ran according to schedule. But the moment the cast and crew broke for supper, the buzzing began in earnest.
Norman, you've got to send her home. Millie Clay's poison on a picture. She thrives on our agony.
Look, Herb, we need the publicity.
We don't need the kind she'll give us. The way Paul and Robin are carrying on, she'll kill us. We'll never get the picture finished.
Yeah, we'll only be here five more days. I can handle Millie Clay. Come on. Let's get a drink before our star taps us out. Get me another bottle, Mitch.
You're not through with that one yet. Come on, Paul, lay off that stuff. You're juice.
I want to go unconscious. It's the only way I can stand making these rotten pictures.
Let's go over your lines for tomorrow.
What are you, my fairy godmother? Mitch, all you've got to do is fall down when I'm supposed to and take a punch now and then. You're not being paid to give advice.
You're the star.
You bet I am. Now go get me another bottle.
I'm telling you, the studio's not going to be happy with Paul's performance. He's got to dry out.
Now, look, Herb, you're the link in the pipeline, huh? And tell them what they want to hear. They'll scream about the budget anyway. Why cause them further upset over something so trivial as a personality clash on the set? Can I help it if their stars hate each other's guts?
Don't look now, but Miss Happiness just walked in, and she's breathing fire.
Norman, I have to talk to you. Alone.
Oh, yes, I was just leaving. See you when the sun comes up.
Yes, Robin, dear, what is it?
You know perfectly well what it is. Paul Helms. Now, how do you expect me to play the lover of a man I despise?
You're an actress. Think of it as a challenge, honey.
I signed for this picture because you were directing. I wanted to work with you.
And you are doing just marvelously. I know how Paul can be.
I'm a professional, and I demand to be treated as one.
But just ignore him, honey.
You try ignoring somebody who's constantly pawing at you, making snide remarks. It's affecting my performance.
Now, Robin, you are perfect for the part. I've said that all along.
Norman, I don't know how I can go on.
Oh, well, your show is both in the morning, honey. Now, you try to get some sleep. I'll talk to Paul.
And please keep Millie Clay away from me.
Yes, I will. You know, Robin, after we finish the picture and the critics tell us what geniuses we are, you'll laugh at how serious this all seems right now. Bees in a Bonnet is going to be a super movie in spite of Paul Helms and Millie Clay and everything else.
Oh, Norman. Do you really think so?
No, I don't think so. I know it will.
Well, it was another eventful day in the making of what will probably be one of the most uneventful movies of the year. For Norman Shonoff's sake, the dear man, I hope the filming is concluded briskly and without further incident. More clay pigeons tomorrow. M.C.
All right, Todd. That's it for today. On the cold day. Let's get ready for the front. We still have the light.
Thank you, Robin. You were sensational.
Oh, thank you, love. It was easy playing that scene without the added burden of my leading man.
Robin, darling.
Oh, hello, Millie.
Norman, you don't mind if I pick your star's brains, do you?
Well, you better ask her. They're her brains. Is Mitch up on the second floor yet?
Tell me, darling. A dear friend of mine tells me that your ex is about to remarry. Would you care to comment? Something I can quote, of course.
Move those booms. We need this area clear.
Norman, I can't find Paul. We got revised pages for him.
Yeah, try the trailer, Herb. The one with the booth.
Yeah, right.
All right, let's move it. Last shot of the day.
Now, please, Millie, can't it wait?
Darling, I'm offering you equal time.
Well, I'd rather not comment for publication. Now, if you don't mind, I'd like to change.
Oh, just one question.
Oh, all right.
A little bird told me that someone on the set has been carrying a torch for you for a long time. I take it that it's not Paul Helms.
You'd better change the newspaper in your bird's cage, sweetheart.
All right, Lenny, now get it in one take if you can. It's a straight drop. He'll be coming through the open window, hit the awning, which will collapse. Then he jumps to his feet. He takes a few steps towards the door, and that's all we need.
Norman, your starlet is not very cooperative today.
Please, Millie, not now.
Quiet, everybody!
These are not on that window fall exterior, sir. Take one. Rolling. Action!
Who closed that window? Please, lady.
Looks like your stuntman's shaken up.
What's the matter with you, Mitch? You missed the awning.
Norman, he's hurt.
Oh, no. Mitch, you all right? Mitch. What the devil's going on? Paul? Paul?
Paul?
This is Paul Helms. He's dead.
Oh, my goodness, he's dead.
Positive. Death was caused by a blow to the left temporal bone. He hit the ground on his right side and broke his shoulder.
So somebody threw Paul out the window?
That's right. What's the stuntman's name?
Varga. Mitchell Varga. You haven't seen him?
No.
You think he did it?
Can't say. You said the Helms wouldn't win any popularity contests.
You had to wait in line to hate him. The public loved him, though.
Well, somebody hated him. Bad. Somebody here. The area's sealed off. We've already questioned the crew. Anybody else see it happen?
Yeah. Gossip columnist, Millie Clay.
Oh, is she here?
That's her typing.
No fooling. Hey, my wife reads her column all the time.
You want to talk to her?
Sure do.
I've never hated a man more, Robin said to me, not 5 minutes before Paul Helms plunged to his death. Director Norman Sharnoff was visibly shaken. Oh, yes.
Millie, the police are here.
They want to talk to me?
Miss Clay, I'm Sergeant Rich Taylor. I'm heading up the investigation here.
Oh.
Maybe you could throw some light on the situation.
I'll be glad to do anything I can, Sergeant Taylor.
My wife, Yvonne, reads your column all the time.
Well, I'm glad.
You know, Millie, you're not going to print this, are you?
Well, why not?
Well, you can't. That's why not.
Norman, I'm surprised at you.
Well, I'm afraid you can't print this, Miss Clay. Not until we're through with the investigation, anyway. It could get you in trouble.
Well, I'll be in bigger trouble with my editor if I don't phone this in.
Hey, I'm sorry, but I can't let you do that. We've got to keep the lid on this thing for now.
Well, we'll see.
Millie?
Miss Clay, you saw the man fall?
Yes, I did.
Did you happen to notice anyone in the window before or after Mr. Helms came through it?
No, sir, I didn't.
Have you seen Mitchell Varga since that time?
No, again.
Do you have any idea who might have killed Mr. Helms?
I have lots of ideas, but I'm saving them until you're through with your investigation.
Now, Millie, please.
Well, thanks for your trouble, Miss Clay.
No trouble, Sergeant Taylor. Norman.
What?
Wasn't there a camera going when it happened? I mean, wouldn't the whole thing be on film?
Yeah, you're right. We did shoot the scene.
Oh, well, could we see it?
Yeah, come on. I'll see if the dailies were processed.
Director Norman Sharnoff was visibly shaken and came to this reporter for comfort and advice. Mother said there'd be days like this. Tomorrow I'll have an exclusive interview with the elusive Robin Albright, and wouldn't it be just like a Hollywood movie if her secret admirer and the mystery man in the window were one and the same? More clay pigeons to come. M.C.
Can I see you a minute?
Oh, sure, Herb. I got all good. We saw the rushes last night. They didn't show a thing.
We got trouble. There's a leak.
What are you talking about?
Your friend with the typewriter got through to the papers. I just got word from the studio. They're going crazy back there with phone calls. They want to know if it's true that Robin had something to do with Helms' death.
Oh, brother. Does Taylor know about this?
I don't know.
Well, I better go find Millie before Taylor does.
You better find her before Robin does.
I mean to sue you and your editor for every penny you could ever hope to make.
Robin, darling, you're talking gibberish. Your career will skyrocket from the publicity.
Oh, you're so full of beans. Now get out of my sight.
I've put down fresh newspaper in my birdcage, Robin, dear. The little sparrow's hungry. Would you like to feed her the name of your tittle dove?
Get out of here.
Millie, what have you done?
Norman, I'm quitting.
Oh, look, you're just tense.
Get her away from me before I kill her.
You don't have to threaten me, dear. Well, it's Sergeant Taylor.
I suppose you read the newspaper.
Yep. We're going to have a little talk, Miss Clay.
You can't stop me from printing the truth.
I don't know about that, but I have some bad news for everyone. We found Mitchell Varga. He's dead. You're under emotional strain, Miss Albright, but could you please answer the question?
Oh, it's so terrible. It's like a nightmare.
You knew Mitchell Varga?
Yes. We were almost married once. I married someone else. And it's my fault that he's dead.
Oh, there, there, Miss Albright. It'll all be over soon. Have you been seeing Mr. Varga lately?
No. I didn't know he would be here. I didn't even know he doubled for Paul Helms. They were so different. Mitch was so sensitive.
You didn't like Mr. Helms.
How could I? How could anybody? He was the most arrogant man I ever met.
You didn't kill him.
What?
That was a statement, not a question.
Of course I didn't kill him. I hated him, but I wouldn't kill him.
Miss Clay referred to a secret admirer in her latest column. That would be Mitchell Varga?
Don't tell me you believe that woman.
Well, personally, I can't stand her. My wife, on the other hand...
Are you saying that Mitch pushed Paul Helms out that window?
He couldn't have. Mitch was dead before it happened.
What? Oh, can't you stop Millie Clay from writing those lies?
Oh, I couldn't, but I've let her do it up till now.
You knew she called in that story?
Mm-hmm.
But why?
Professional reasons. There's something you should understand, Miss Albright. The very first thing I did when I was assigned to this case was hire Millie Clay. She's working for me.
Finished, Norman. You know that, don't you?
And then the studio's junking the picture?
Yep. They'll write it off. We'll still get our money.
Uh-huh. If we ever get out of this desert. What do you make of this latest development?
You mean about Mitch?
Yeah.
Beats me. I thought he killed Helm. Now I don't know what to think. Taylor talked to the studio, told him he'd see to it that Millie was muzzled.
No, it's a little late for that, isn't it?
Yeah, I guess so.
Do you feel like a nightcap?
No, thanks. I'm drained. I think I'll turn in.
Okay, I'll see you in the morning, Herb.
Good night, Norman.
She's not there, Herb.
What? How did you...
Drop the pipe. Drop it.
I didn't mean to, but...
Oh, the Tall, I couldn't stand the way he treated Robin. Always calling her names and touching her. She hated him, and so did I. So I...
Millie, what a terrible woman. She was on to me. I had to get rid of her.
It was Mitch I didn't mean to kill. I just tapped him, just a little tap. I didn't want him to die.
I did it for her, for Robin. I loved her, only I never told her. But I had to prove it to her. I had to show her.
Well, you chose the wrong way, I'm afraid. Herbert Griffin?
Yes?
I'm placing you under arrest on 2 counts of first-degree murder.
Lunch today at Salvino's with the stunning Robin Albright, just back from 2 weeks in sunny Acapulco. She told me between bites of pasta of her new 3-picture deal with Upaskins Productions. How the lady stays so trim, I'll never know. This reporter pushed her leafy salad around the plate throughout the entire meal. Dear Norman Shawnoff rides from Kyoto, where he's scouting locations for his upcoming thriller, The Velvet Scepter. Oh, I wish I were there too, Norman. A special CP to Yvonne and Rich Taylor of Mojave. You have a standing invitation to my humble canyon digs if and when you can stand my cooking. I promise not to serve any clay pigeons, you beautiful people. At least until tomorrow. M.C.
I'm Rod Serling. Close your eyes, exercise your imagination, and join us again on our next presentation of The Zero Hour.
Clay Pigeons is an original radio drama by Kim Weisskopf. Lee Meriwether was heard as Millie Clay. Featured in the cast were Ben Wright, Maggie Mullooly, Olin Soul, Byron Kane, and Joe DeSantis. Zero Hour, created by J.M. Coates, directed by Don Hills, is produced in Hollywood for the Mutual Broadcasting System by Radio Productions Incorporated. Music is composed and conducted by Stanley D. Hoffman. Rochelle Sherman, associate producer. This has been a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System.